Thank you all for joining. I will start by a brief introduction of the speakers today, and then I will hand over the mic to them for presentation and to mesmerize us with their experiences. So today's speakers are well known to us. All of you who have joined are either friends, family, or known people. Amisha and Riyansh are the mother and son duo. Both are from Mumbai, born and brought up in Mumbai. And Amisha's husband is Pinesha, and he is a wildlife photographer. Riyash used to live with them. Amisha is a BA major. She is in philosophy and psychology. She runs her own business as a floral designer, and she loves to take videos in the wild, the behavior of birds and animals, and that's what I think has inspired her to give today's session as well. Whereas Riyansh, on the other hand, he has, as they say in the tiger world, he has separated from the mother, and the cub has gone somewhere else. He's recently completed his bachelor's in architecture from Kingston University, London, and now he is pursuing his master's in architecture from the same university. He was stuck in London during the initial period of lockdown, and he has last week he has come back to Mumbai to be with his family. Unfortunately, he's still not with his family. He's holed up in a hotel as quarantined as directed by the government. But bird watching is his passion, and he prefers to study their behavior with his binoculars. I've seen him with his binoculars without his camera on the field. He loves music as well. See, they both have, I've known both of them through the ornithology course by BNHS, and they both have completed the course. As a family, they travel a lot. They have traveled to, I think, many of the continents, USA, London, Paris, East Africa, and a few more countries. But since they started enjoying the wildlife and birding, now they prefer to go to only forests or wherever there is a birding place. And that's what I have been told. They have explored most of the forests in India, to name a few, LRK, Thol, Nal Sarovar, Big One, Sattal, Pangod, all these are birding locations, Koorg, Charidand, in Kutch, and many more. And what I'm going to invite Amisha and Riyansh is take us through all these journeys and a few more if you have your wildlife journeys, birding journeys, and you know, help us understand nature a little bit better than what we understand, and obviously share your experiences. Over to you, Amisha.
Yeah, so thank you, Francis, for the introduction. Thank you so much, Francis, and for giving us this opportunity. Thank you, friends, for joining us in today to allow us to share our experiences with y'all. So before I start, let me begin with explaining you how Nature's Palette came into existence, or why Nature's Palette came into existence, and what is NCLUB. So we used to, my husband, in before a few years, had traveled to went to Olekarwadi for a butterfly trail with a renowned macro photographer, Mr. Yuvraj Gujjar, and he had a wonderful experience there. Here in the pictures, you can see the praying mantis, the striped tiger, the common pirate, and the grey pansy. So during this trip is when he got to know about a trip to Bandhavgarh, which Yuvraj was conducting. And we all decided to join him. So Bandhavgarh was a wonderful experience. We clicked, we captured emotions of so many different animals. But the most interesting thing what happened, Bandhavgarh being our first forest trip, in the very first safari and in the very first 15 minutes what we experienced just left us speechless. So it was early in the morning, the winter mornings, the sun was not yet out. We had just entered the forest, and in the first 15 minutes, we are moving ahead and a spotted deer takes a big leap in front of our gypsy, and there comes a tiger behind. We were all so thrilled, we missed our heartbeats. And this is a tiger, the very first tiger sighting of our life. The light was very low and we had to use the flash. But after this thrilling experience, there was no looking back. So we, in the last 12 years, we traveled to a lot of tiger reserves, national parks, and a lot of birding places too. So what used to happen is when we used to plan a forest safari and we used to ask our friends or families, nobody used to be, ready to come along with us. Like, kisi ko bola ki chalo Nainital chalte. But for a forest safari, nobody agreed. So then what we used to do is either we used to travel, three of us by ourselves, or maybe just could manage to get one or two friends to come along. And in all these 12 years, we studied the places so well. We got connected to the best of naturalists of all these places and even the best of places to stay. And then before a year, we planned to come up with Nature's Palette. So Nature's Palette is just 1 year old, and in which these last 3 months went in the lockdown. And in these this 1 year, we traveled to 5 different forests. And I'm sharing a few pictures with y'all of the happy faces who traveled with us. All our safaris were super fun and super successful. So here is again one example, a senior couple and a 10-year-old boy. They didn't even meet each other before the safari, but I guess forests and nature are so magical. They get like-minded people connected so well. We also see to it that we travel together. We arrange for a big table so that we can have all our meals together. So right from leaving our house for the trip and coming back home, we are all together only discussing about wildlife, about birds, about forest, and sharing knowledge and sharing our experiences. So friends, let me take you all to an online forest safari today. I hope you all enjoy it. So before, in the beginning years, it used to be a rush to reach to the gate first. You know, it used to be a topic of discussion ki aaj hamari gypsy first enter hui, ya hum 2 minute late ho gaye, nahi to hamari gypsy first hoti. Agreed, it is good if you can enter early or enter, be the first ones to enter, because the forest is undisturbed and you get good sightings. But in all these years, we have learned that good sightings only depends like 80% on destiny and 20% on your knowledge and your alertness. So yeah. So now let us enter the forest. Let us feel the silence and the beauty of the forest. It really takes us to a meditative state. So the topography of all the forests is different, but all forests have their own beauty. For me, my favorite forest topography wise is the Ranthambore National Park. But to go to Ranthambore, you really need to have a very, very strong, you need to be very strong physically. The roads are so rocky there. I mean, we really go for a wild ride for almost 3 to 4 hours. So your backbone needs to be really strong there. I'm sharing one beautiful moment we experienced in Ranthambore. Thank you. this was one place where we actually waited for more than half an hour, and these beautiful sea fowls, they were almost like 5 to 6 around us with a dozen of females feeding there. And these beautiful peafowls were displaying, doing their courtship display. It was a wonderful experience. So again, one more video. This is one of my favorite place. You see the video first and then I explain you. Okay, there's no sound. Okay, so this is one place in the forest where we just love to spend maximum time. So we see to it that even our gypsies are put off so that no kind of sound disturbs us. And this is an artificial water body created, but there are small natural water bodies also. And the best experience was in Kabini, not in Kabini, in Kanha. There, near one small water body, there were so many different species of bird. I didn't even want to distract myself by taking pictures or taking a movie. We just wanted to note the behavior of the birds. There were like 4 type of drongos. There were two types of kingfishers. There were babblers. There were silverbills. There were peafowls, green beaters. There were so many. There were tree pies also. There were so many different species of birds there. So this is one place where we really like to spend time without making any kind of noise. So yes, that's Noor. Noor is a daughter of the legendary Machli. We have all heard about stories, about Machli's stories. She generally, tigers nowadays, they survive like, you know, for around 16 years. That's their lifespan. But Machli lived for long 20 years in spite of losing her canines at a very early age. So she lost her canines in the fight of during a fight with a crocodile to save her young ones. So that's how she is one of the favorites. We were a little unfortunate. We could not click Machli, but we did see her resting in a bush. She was a little old then. Next, we go to the Kanha National Park. Kanha is an evergreen forest. So here, the famous and the favorite male tiger, that's Munna. Munna is, it's very easy to identify Munna because of the CAT written on its forehead. If you all notice it, the CAT written on the forehead. I'll show it to you all again. Here. That's very prominent. And he's Chota Munna. Okay, let me tell you something about Munna. Munna had killed somebody in the forest, and right now he's not in the forest. He's kept in the zoo. That's one sad thing. And he is Chota Munna, Munna's son. Even it's very easy to recognize Chota Munna because of this big hump it has here. A few more clicks. I love clicking the spotted deers and noting their activities too. That's a very, very shy animal. It's very aggressive, the sloth bear, but they see to it, the tiger and the sloth bear, they both do not want to come in front of each other or in each other's territories because they both are equally strong and equally aggressive. They do not want to create a fight. That's one thing we learned about the sloth bears and the tigers. Okay, one more very interesting bird. That's a video, I'll put it on for y'all. But it's a spot-bellied eagle owl, one very rare bird to be sighted in the daytime. Even the naturalists and the drivers were amazed to see this bird. They had not seen it since years. And I'll just play the video first. And if you all note a black eyebrow kind of a thing here, so it is with this that they express. So again, this sighting was so beautiful just because, I mean, we were leaving the forest and we sighted this bird at a very, very low level branch just besides the road. It was so close. The bird was not even bothered or disturbed with the human presence over there. But since it was time up, we had to leave the bird and go. Yeah, next we go to the Kaziranga. That's in the east of India. Kaziranga again is a very, very rich forest for birding. So this was, we used to go, we had been there in December, and this was one early morning around say 5:36 when we were going for an elephant ride. So we had to cross a small bridge over the Brahmaputra River, and trust me, I didn't want to get out of this place because this beauty, this was so mesmerizing, the rising of the sun and early mornings, a little fog with the fishermen fishing. It was so beautiful. So one rewarding moment of Kaziranga, I should say, that same morning when we were on the elephant, we could see, we got to see the single horn rhinos mating. So now these rhinos, the single horn rhinos, are found only in Kaziranga and nowhere else in the world. They are again one of the India's big five. So to complete seeing India's big five, you have to visit Kaziranga. So this was one moment. We were on the elephant a little too close to them. They are otherwise shy animals, but very aggressive too. We were scared, but we didn't want to get out of there. We just wanted to, you know, capture these moments, which we didn't know when we would get to see next. One very sad thing about Kaziranga is every year during the monsoons, there are heavy floods there. Almost like 700 to 800 animals die every year. Even the year before we went, the monsoon before we went, there were 800 plus animals who died in Kaziranga. So that's really sad. Again, one more, the Indian bison, again, one of the big fives clicked in Kaziranga. These are the open-billed storks. So they mainly eat snails, and these open bills help them to separate the snails from the shell. They somehow discard the shell and eat the snails. So something interesting. The black-necked storks, the one in the front with the yellow eye is a female, and the one behind with the black eye is the male. The darter, or the snake bird as we call it, this bird again, you know, sits like the cormorant with wings open to dry itself. It's really beautiful to capture this bird too. The lesser adjutant, we had seen there were a lot of greater adjutants also. As I said, Kaziranga is really rich in birds. So, but we could not click the greater adjutants as they were very far. The lesser adjutant again in flight. So we go to Kabini next. Kabini is in the south of India. And I have a very, very interesting story. Do concentrate. It's going to be thrilling for you guys too. So here we had a naturalist who was an expert and an experienced one. From 2 kilometers away, he could sense some action going on somewhere, and he could even smell the scent monkey. So he says it smells like basmati rice. Very difficult for us to, you know, identify the smell. We did try sniffing, but obviously he was an experienced naturalist. So then we decided to go to this place. We waited here, and behind us was a tiger. And here in the side, in the bushes, there was a leopard hiding. So we couldn't even, I mean, it was so camouflaged, but the naturalist told us to leave beside the tiger and we concentrate on the leopard, because noting his behavior, he thought that some action is going to take place. So this is what happened then. From the bush, the leopard came out. It came out on the road and it was, you know, it saw on both the sides, and then it crossed the road. It crossed the road and it went to the other side and it stopped there. So it stopped here and it was constantly looking in one direction. So we were sure that something is going to happen. We were patient and we were just waiting with our heartbeats increasing a little. And there he spotted a spotted deer. So that's what he was targeting at. We couldn't even see the spotted deer, but then somehow we could make out, you know, that yes, he is looking at something. So then what happened within like a few minutes, the leopard pounced at the deer in front of us, and it walked out with his kill, as if he's walking out with a trophy in his hand. Looking at this picture, I just, you know, can think of a few, this two words, that this is the eyes of life and death. This is again an award-winning picture, which my husband has won an award for this photograph. And this is one moment which we will cherish and remember all our life. So these are a few pictures I'm sharing about the fight. This was a fight of these spotted deers, and we could literally hear the sound of the horns banging with each other. That's the Malabar pit viper, a poisonous snake. That's the serpent eagle, mainly feeds on snakes. The Malabar pied hornbill. Friends, why are these called Malabar? Because they are only found in the Malabar regions, which is in the south of India. And the beautiful Asian fairy bluebird. So this, we had gone to Vaitri Resort from Kabini, and we had we were in the tree house for one night. Trust me, all the bird lovers and nature lovers should go to Vaitri Resort once and stay in the tree house. Experience the tree house. They are so high up, like we had to climb 60 to 70 steps to reach our room. And the whole canopy, the whole mountain is below us. And there are so many beautiful birds there. So the electric blue color and the red eye was something which was so attractive. The white-bellied woodpecker, among the largest woodpeckers of India. The ornithology friends, if you all remember, we were walking on the roads of Goa birding, and we suddenly heard the woodpecker call. We saw this bird flying and we ran behind it. It was a beautiful trip. The Goa was a beautiful trip too. Next, we go to the Pench National Park. So Pench National Park, a part of it is in MP and the other part is in Maharashtra. Man-made boundaries though, animals do not know any boundaries. And as I told you, we love to capture emotions of the animals, and the black-faced langurs are so very expressive. That's the dole dog. They are generally found in groups. They kill in groups, and they don't even let their kill die or, you know, fall on the ground. Even if the kill is running to save itself, they start eating lumps from their body. That's the gray fox. Again, a beautiful leap of a spotted deer. And for the first comers who traveled to the forest with us to Pench for the first time, they loved all the safaris. They enjoyed the safaris, but this sighting was like the icing on the cake for them. She is a famous tigress, Collarwali, and she was with her four cubs. I couldn't take the fourth cub in the frame. But again, this was a beautiful, beautiful moment we spent with the tigers of Pench. Let's go to Tadoba. So we all know Tadoba so very well now. Back in 2000, back before, I think 2014, hardly anybody used to travel to Tadoba. There were hardly any places, decent places to stay in Tadoba. But after 2014, Tadoba became very, very famous. And let's see why. Yeah. So there, this is an Indian roller, again, very commonly found in all the forests. And we would love to see it flying because the colors are very, very beautiful. That's again my favorite, the Asian paradise flycatcher. So this bird, when the male is a juvenile, it is rufous in color. And as it turns into an adult, it becomes white in color. And the female is always rufous in color, but does not have a long tail. And this is one bird I always crave seeing in the forests, and I want to see them flying. They look beautiful. So that's the proudly standing Indian pita. The thickney. This bird was right in front of our gypsy. We took a few minutes to actually spot where it is because it was so camouflaged. That's the white-throated kingfishers, of course. We enjoyed clicking them. And that's the changeable hawk eagle. The changeable hawk eagle is with a squirrel kill here, and there are a few crows who are trying to steal the kill. You enjoy the call of this hawk eagle.
What's this?
I think it dropped the kill. So that the hawk eagle, that was one, the changeable hawk eagle, that was one place where we were the only gypsies standing there and, enjoying the behavior of the eagle. There was a tiger behind us and all the other gypsies were there clicking the tiger. But I think we enjoyed this as... So that's what we enjoyed, clicking the hawk eagle rather than going and looking at the tiger. So here, this is the famous male tiger of Tadopa. His name is Wagdo. So Wagdo is today he's supposed to be the largest tiger of India, and he has contributed a lot in increasing the population of tigers in Tadopa. And you just note the note the size of his body and the size of his head. His head is so huge. We couldn't take a very clear picture because it was a little far away from us. But yes, and that's his mate Madhuri. So Madhuri again has contributed a lot in increasing the population. She had in her first litter given birth to three cubs. In her fourth litter, four cubs. And in her second litter, four cubs. Third litter, four cubs. And fourth litter, again, three cubs. So, and all of them were quite healthy. And one very astonishing fact about the tigers of Tadopa, generally the male tigers, do not take care of their young ones. And the female actually has to protect her young ones from the male, even though he is the father of those cubs. But in Tadopa, the male tigers, they live as a family. Tigers are solitary generally, right? But here the tigers live as a family. So that's one good thing to know about Tadopa tigers. So that's one of the daughters or one of the litters of Wagdo and Madhuri. She's Lara. Now it's so easy to identify the tigers of Tadopa. I'll show you how. Note the prominent L mark on her face. Yes, so that's how she is called, Lara. That's Geeta. Again, note the prominent G on her face. Yes, so that's the G on her face. She's Mona. Mona has a very prominent M mark on her face. And that's Sonam. Sonam again has a prominent S on her neck. So that's how these girls are named and identified by the wildlife lovers. So about Sonam, when she was young, when she was small, she was very weak compared to her other sisters. But when she grew up today she dominates the famous Thalia Lake of Tadopa. She's also got two litters. In first litter, she gave birth to three cubs. And right now, she's with her second litter with two cubs. And she's a very, very dominating tigress. So I'm sharing a very, very beautiful moment we spend with the tigers of Tadopa. And probably this is the best moment. Just note their emotions. You know, this is the best moment of all these 12 years we have spent with tigers.
Thank you.
So seeing a mother or female tigress feeding her cubs, I don't know when again we'll be able to get such wonderful moments. So friends, now I'm sharing two videos with you all, which we had, we had taken in during the 21 days of quarantine. We had posted 21 videos on social media just to educate our friends, very short videos. So the first video gives a little knowledge, a basic knowledge about tigers. And in the second video, we see how to track tigers in the forest. I hope you enjoy this.
Hi, good evening. Friends, whenever we plan a forest trip, what is the first thing that comes in our mind? Kaun se forest mein jyada tiger sightings hai? Even we get questions like, tiger sightings hoga na? Forests have a lot more to offer. It's not just tiger sightings. Lekin ye baat bhi sahi hai. Ki agar tiger dekhne mil gaya, to life jingle aana. Track a tiger. That we'll see tomorrow. Before that, let's look at a few interesting facts about tigers. Tigers are the largest cat species in the world, reaching up to 3.3 meters in length and weighing up to 670 pounds. Tigers are solitary creatures. Unlike most other cats, tigers are great swimmers and actually like the water. The life expectancy of tiger is between 20 to 25 years, whether they are kept in captivity or in wild. However, most die before the age of 20. Cubs are born blind and only open their eyes 1 to 2 weeks after birth, and only half of the cubs survive. Cubs start learning to hunt at 6 months of age, but stay with their moms until they are 18 months old. Tigers communicate using scent markings, visual signals, and lots of sounds like roars, growls, snarls, grunts, moans, mews, and hisses. Tigers have antiseptic saliva. At full speed, tigers can reach up to 65 kilometers per hour, and no two tigers have the same stripes. Tigers are very precious, and we tourists, along with the naturalists and the forest department, play a very important role in conserving them. We come back tomorrow with a few tips on how to trace a tiger. Have a good day. Share with you a few tips on how to track a tiger. Tracking a tiger is even more thrilling than sighting a tiger. But remember, patience and silence are the two important things we should maintain. When we reach the forest gate, there are a few interesting signs which we should not miss seeing. Nobody can assure you a tiger, and that is the fun of it. Friends, it's very important that we reach the gate before time so that we can be the first ones to enter. Take a little information about the forest and the previous sightings of the particular zone. And also, using all our senses like sound, smell, and sight is a key to track a tiger in the wild. Like, look at these scratch marks on the trees, which are done by the tiger to mark its territory. They also do scent marking to mark their territories with smells like butter popcorn. A few experienced guides can even recognize this smell. Pug marks are one of the key things to look out for. We can also see and differentiate between the male and female tiger. Stop, pause, and listen to the jungle. let the jungle talk to you. Many animals give alarm calls if the tiger is around them. The call of a spotted deer and the sambar deer are very strong assurances of the tiger being around. We should then notice their behavior and the direction in which they are looking at. So this is how we traced a tiger in Tadoba. Enjoy our experience.
Enjoyed this, and so we had made 21 such short videos, and if you all want to see them all, they are on my Facebook, Amisha Shah. And friends, I had to tell you about N Club. So N Club, we are coming up with N Club. It's an initiative to bring along like-minded people. Like how I said, when we wanted to go for forest safaris or bird watching, nobody used to agree to come with us. So in N Club, all the members, we will meet at least once a month, plan activity for at least once a month, and maybe go half a day birding or have indoor sessions, share knowledge, call some speaker and learn something from them. So we were supposed to start our activities from the month of June, but now again, we'll have to delay it a little. I'll keep you all updated and we'll love to have you all with us. So thank you, friends, and I hope you enjoyed the forest safaris. Over to Riyansh now.
So hello, everybody. I'm Riyansh. And as Francis told you that I was studying architecture, I'm studying architecture masters in UK. And luckily, I got this opportunity through my university where we could collaborate with Naturalists of London and design a bird hide and construct it for them in a nature reserve. After submitting my ornithology portfolio and telling them about my experiences and my aims of what I want to do in life, like combine wildlife and architecture and do something good for nature, they accepted me in the studio and made me the project manager for the Hyde project, which is an amazing experience, like probably the first step that I would ever take in terms of combining wildlife with architecture. But today, I'm going to talk to you all about the two trips that we took. One was from Sattal and Pangot. So this trip to Sattal and Pangot, if we've got a lot of bird watchers with us and people who are hopefully prospective bird watchers, Sattal Pangot is a trip that you must go. It's a paradise for bird watchers. Like I think we went there after 6 or 7 years of experience, which I had in bird watching, more for my parents probably. But we still saw more than 150 new species in that one trip. So it's absolutely brilliant. So let's start with looking at what the kind of experience we had in Sattal was. So we used to drive up from our hotel to one of these kind of hills or mountains and just stop the car anywhere, just get out, let the car follow us slowly from behind. But we would just walk the roads for like 5, 10 kilometers without stopping or without just, without any kind of thing, just having kind of our ears and eyes open, listening to bird sounds, looking for them. And I remember having neck pains after those days. because you're just continuously looking up. It's an amazing experience. So this is just another photograph of us trying to not do bird watching for once, and actually be a part of nature, like we are in, like we are the wild, and kind of experiencing how the wild must, like the wilderness must be experiencing nature as well. This is another photograph just showing you how not everything would be found on the road. It's like you have to trek a lot. Like Satal Pangot was a good example of how fit you need to be to actually be able to go bird watching, because it's not just you sitting in a gypsy, for example, in a forest safari, where you still need to be fit because the roads are bad. But when it comes to birding, you have to keep walking and you have to have patience. And you need to be fairly fit to be able to go to different places for bird watching. But this photograph also tells you about another story about, I think, the same area, Satal Pangot, the whole of Nainital actually. It had a 90-day forest fire, which was terrible, right before we had gone. We had gone, I think, in the end of May, a few years back. And because of that 90-day forest fire, there was so much loss of wildlife, but even after that, we were able to see around 150 new species. So this photograph is kind of showing how everything was burnt out in the area of Satal and Pangot. I'm going to play a video. This is a slightly long video, but it kind of shows all the experiences, the beautiful birds that we saw, and kind of their behaviors that we depicted and kind of understood and read throughout the trip. That this particular owl, it's a brown wood owl, but this is a juvenile of a brown wood owl. If anybody's been to Satal, they must know that there's this studio which is that small water body, which is known as a studio, as you can see so many different species over there. And this brown wood owl was seen on the way to it, and that's a long-tailed birdbill. It's a very beautiful bird again, and this pair had been using this nest for the third time this year, and we know that the photographers would actually stay there for 10-12 hours just to get a good shot of these birds, because they're absolutely beautiful, and they're very, very expressive, very quirky birds. That's a white-throated thrush. Again, a very common bird in that region. These birds again are Satal is very well known for these birds because they're extremely expressive. And then that's the streaked laughing thrush. Apologies for the lag in video, because it's because of the internet. That is a blue whistling thrush. It's called a whistling thrush because it's got a very, very beautiful whistle to its call. And it's a wonderful bird. Like, once you hear this bird, you can never forget the whistle of this bird. That's a greater barbet. It's the largest barbet found in India. And you cannot miss this bird because it's quite big and it's very, it's shy, but it's quite expressive once you see it. That's a Himalayan bulbul. Again, a very, very bold bird, and it expresses, like, as you could see, it expresses its behavior very well. That's a gray-headed woodpecker. That's a black-headed jay. Like, everybody knows what a mockingjay is. That's a black-headed jay. which is again fairly commonly found in Satal. These are the whiskered euhenia. So this is a very interesting story. I'm going to pause the video for a bit. These whiskered euhenia, they are very difficult to miss, as if you've ever heard the sound of a scops owl, scops owl are very well known to feed on the eggs of other birds. So these birds, whenever they hear the sound of a scops owl, these are the first ones to come and try to shoo it away. And they're very aggressive in that sense. And you can never forget these birds because of the whiskers that they have. That's a Rufus sebia. We had seen this right behind the our hotel in Pangot. Again, a very, very melodious, but I can't remember the sound of it. It's a very melodious bird. That's how we had found it. That's a red-billed blue magpie. These birds are crow family, and from that family, these birds have the longest tail. And you see another species called the yellow-billed blue magpie slightly north from Pangot. And then this is a very interesting video of how these magpies were actually protecting their area and the food around their area from the monkeys which had come to eat it. So they were troubling these monkeys. It's slightly unclear, but you can see that the magpie is coming and hitting the monkey on its head. So this is another very beautiful bird found in that region. It's called the white-crested laughing thrush. And you can't see it very commonly around. They're fairly shy. But we had drove for around 40 kilometers to reach a chai stall, like a tea stall on the middle of the road. And for some reason, there's a couple of pairs of these birds, the white-crested laughing thrush, come there every day at the same time for 30 minutes, and they eat the leftovers of the food and they go away. So it's that tea stall has become very famous just because of these birds. They're very, very beautiful. That's a striated laughing thrush. We had seen this very close to the river, the photograph in which I was sitting in a on the rock in a river. This photograph was taken very close to it. And this, I think with this bird we saw, we finished all the laughing thrushes of Satal and Pangot. And it's a very smart looking bird, I'd say. That's a crested kingfisher, again in the same river in which I was sitting. These birds, this is the largest kingfisher of India. And they are always very close to the river, so they won't be spotted higher up in the trees very often, but they'll be spotted more on the rocks. And last but not the least, the Verdita flycatcher. I don't think anybody can forget this bird once you see it in the wild. It's so bright blue. I think this is a female, not even a male, but if you see a male Verdita flycatcher, it's much brighter than this, and it's absolutely beautiful. But now let's go to Kenya. This is the second trip I want to talk about. Moving away slightly from birding, Africa is again a whole different kind of wildlife. So if anybody's been to Africa, or if you've seen African forests on TV, you know that they've got the wide savannas, the fields. And they're very different from Indian forests, which are fairly dense in terms of canopy. And it's a completely different experience from an Indian forest. This is one of the most well-known factor of an African forest, the migration of the wildebeest along with the zebras. This particular photograph is taken very close to where the river migration happens. So that river migration is very famous for crocodiles hunting wildebeests, because they stay hungry for a very long period of time, knowing that the wildebeests are going to migrate and they are going to get a lot of food for sure. But unfortunately, we were able to see the migration, but not through the river. So we were just waiting over there for, I think, the entire day, just hoping that we'd be able to see the river crossing. But these migrations happen, I think, in August, which is the best time to go to Kenya. And nearly around 2 million wildebeests migrate from Serengeti of Tanzania to Masai Mara in Kenya. That is a tribe. They're very interesting people again. These tribes have a couple of very interesting traditions that got registered in my head. They have a tradition in which you have to stay in the forest without any kind of resources for a particular amount of time before you can actually be called a soldier of their tribe or an adult of their tribe. And after which you get this attire of a soldier. And the second tradition that they have is that whoever jumps the highest amongst the prospective grooms gets to choose his bride first. So gets to choose his mate first. And just a funny thing, I had tried to jump with them and I had jumped higher than most of them. So they had offered me to choose my bride, but then sadly, I was underage. So these are the big five of Africa, as they're very well known. Double horned rhino, the rhino, the elephant, bull and leopard. These animals kind of are the most expressive or the most commonly found in Africa. They're the big five of Africa. So these are the cheetahs. Cheetahs aren't found in India anymore. They became extinct long ago. And I'm just going to share a very common, fair, obvious point. Just to differentiate between a cheetah and a leopard, yes, the spots are different. But many a times we don't get to compare the spots to know which one is which. So an easier way to spot out a cheetah from a leopard is the cry marks that it has, the black cry mark from the eye down its cheek. And these are three cheetah cubs that we had seen on the way to this migration spot when we were traveling to the river. Our guide had gotten a radio call from some other guide, and he said that there are three cheetah cubs who are just playing around and enjoying. And we spent nearly an hour with them. And I'll just play this video just to show you how interesting and how cute these cubs are. And then one of the most memorable stories that we have from Africa was of these vultures. So let me just give you a short story about what had happened. We were looking and photographing a few lions who were feeding on their kill. And then suddenly I spotted a few vultures, actually not a few, a bunch of vultures, and so hovering sky. And then slowly they started coming down, and we could hear them make their screeching calls. So we drove there and we saw that there was this small zebra cub was laying on the ground and the vultures were feeding on it. And then there was this zebra mother just looking at the dead cub and the vultures, just standing there and not being able to do anything. So I'm going to play the video. You could see that the lappet-faced vultures, which are slightly larger and stronger, would open up the zebra and break the levee. And then these Rupel's griffin vultures would feed on them after the lappet-faced vultures are done. And these Rupel's griffin vultures are the birds which are the highest flying birds in the world. So I'll just play the video.
No, just a moment. Yeah, open. This is open.
Not being able to do anything. This is a very long video. Hopefully we'll share it at some point. And it's just the truth of nature. That's a baboon. These baboons again are very, very common in Africa. You can see them every now and then in their families. And they are very aggressive animals. So like there's been a lot of incidents and a lot of stories that we've been told about baboons attacking humans. And they've got very large canines, very long canines. So they can harm the humans in a very serious way. And the hippos. So there's an interesting story about hippos as well. We had gone to Lake Naivasha, if you've heard of it. And we'd gone to this resort called Naivasha River Resort. And that resort is in the middle of a very foresty area. And you've got a lake right next to the resort. And it's very open. So wildlife or wild animals can actually walk through the resort where you are walking. So one evening, it was fairly dark. And my brother and I, we were walking from our room to the dining area. And we heard something running right beside us very, very fast. And continuously, like there was a lot of animals running. So we turned on the flashlight and we could see that a bunch of hippos were running right next to us. And it was very scary. But yeah, like they're fairly harmless animals. And that's the Malachite kingfisher. Again, very beautiful, very bright blue in color. It's very similar to the common kingfisher that we find in India in terms of size and looks, but it's much brighter in terms of color. That is a superb starling. It looks black, completely black in color. But when you see it in sunlight, you can see that the rainbow color is actually, celebrated of this bird. That's why it's called the superb starling. That is a yellow-billed hornbill. Samburu forest. We had seen these hornbills so close to our dining area that during breakfast, they used to actually come onto the table while we were eating, and they're very beautiful and not scared of humans, at least over there at all. And just to share a few other photographs of birds that are found in Africa, that's the great white pelican. The below that is the vulturian guinea fowl. After which is the saddle-billed stork, and the top middle one is the yellow-necked francolin. The one below it is the Egyptian goose. The harrier below it, we don't know which one it is. So if anybody knows, please let us know. But it is a harrier for sure. The hornbill on the top right is a ground hornbill. The one below it is a white-fronted bee-eater. And the last one is a superb starling again. And last but not the least, the most beautiful bird I think everybody would want to see once they go to Africa is the secretary bird. I'm going to play the video first and then let's talk about this. Okay, so if the video wasn't clear enough, I would suggest everybody go on YouTube and have a look at this bird. Have a look at how it walks. It's known as a secretary bird mainly because of its looks, so like those long legs, and the way it walks, it kind of wags its tail or the hips in a particular way. So you know, it depicts a secretary of a corporate office. And these birds are predominantly snake eaters. So they're always seen on ground looking for snakes, and you can see them stomping on the ground to kill the snake. And they're very beautiful birds. They're very beautiful birds. And that ends the story of our trip to Kenya and Satar and Pangot as well. I'll hand it over to Mom again.
Hope you all enjoyed the trips with us today, the online trips. And Francis, you take over now. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thanks a lot, Francis.
Any suggestions, guys, they are most welcome. And someday we all will go together birding, hopefully soon.
Sure. Thank you very much, Amisha and Rian. Very good session. I enjoyed a lot the stories behind each picture and the videos, very well presented and documented. In fact, you had the foresight of, you know, taking those small videos and, you know, so that you can show it to us. There are lots of thanks messages coming on the chat. Please do have a look at those as well. Guys, if you have any questions, please do type in, or you can unmute yourself and ask those questions. Amisha, I have one question. I don't know if you can go back to any of your slides. How do you differentiate male and female based on their pug marks? You showed one slide, it was there in the video. Is there any way you can guide us?
Try and find that particular slide in the video, but I'll just explain until the video, the slide
you
actually.
Explain, I'll play. Yeah, I'll play it.
The male and female pug marks, if you can see them together, obviously you can compare which one is larger, but if not, then the male pug mark, if you draw a kind of a four-figured geometric on it, you would be able to draw a proper square, nearly a proper square. But when you try it on a female pug mark, it will turn out to be a rectangle. So the female pug mark has longer fingers compared to the width of its pug mark. But the male pug mark is fairly square in shape. And that's... it's a fairly easy kind of differentiation once you see.
And the fingers and the palm itself, does it have any differentiation?
Yeah, so the fingers are longer. So the center finger, it's more like our hand, and the male pug mark is more like this. So it'll be an actual square.
I think even the middle finger of the female is a little longer comparatively.
All right, okay. Thanks. That was information.
I just wanted to point out on the chat, those birds weren't from UK. They were Satar and Pangot in first, and then
UK as in Uttarakhand. We were talking about Uttarakhand.
Oh, sorry.
I know UK for you is different. For us, it is local UK.
Yeah. I'll stop sharing the screen. Is that clear, or you want me to show
yeah,
that?
Yeah, that's enough. Yeah, then I'll look it up. Thank you. Guys, anybody has any question? We still have just completed 1 hour, 7 minutes. So we do have some time.
I'll just go through the questions.
Amisha, do you conduct trips to all these national parks?
Yes, we do. That's what we do. I mean, you can like our page, Nature's Palette, on Facebook and Instagram. So you'll get all the updates.
Okay. Fine.
We've come up with our website also. And Radhika, I have your number. I'll save your number and maybe I'll add you in the broadcast group so that you are updated.
Okay, sure. Thanks.
Yeah, welcome.
It was a very lovely presentation. I mean, though I haven't been to Ranthambore and all that, I had a virtual tour.
Thank you. Even you know, while collecting pictures to make this presentation, it was we were like feeling so happy, like, you know, just wanting to go again, missing everything all the more.
Correct.
Anybody wants to chat up with them or ask anything or share anything? Anybody who's on the call, please unmute yourself and ask the question directly. Obviously, you can ask them later on as well, in person or at your personal capacity. But on this forum, okay, Vineet is asking one question. What is your most liked safari in India? So now this is where you put it on the spot.
This is a controversial question, I would say.
Every forest, when we go to that one particular forest, we feel, wow, this is the best. And in every season, like in one forest, if we go in the winters, we feel, wow, winters are the best. If we go in the summers, we feel, wow, summers are the best to go for. It's always different. And no forest, like even Tadoba, we have been there almost more than 10 times. But every time the experience is different. Everything looks different every time. It's always beautiful.
Right. I'll ask you this question. You have been doing wildlife for a long time, you know, and then you did the BNHS course. How has that changed your outlook, or how it has changed you, both of you?
I think it gives you a direction towards what to look for when you're actually going birding. Like, wildlife was a hobby. Now it's become more like you need to spread the awareness. You need to spread awareness about conservation. And you know, like, don't just do nothing with your hobby, like, do something with it. And that was the main change, at least.
And Riyaz, so when you were in Masai Mara, and you said you were too young to take that offer. If you were not young, if you were of good age, what would you have done?
I'll answer that.
He wouldn't have tried jumping only. So I'll just spread one thing right now. Like, just because Riyansh was quarantined, was supposed to be quarantined for 14 days. So we planned a 7 days workshop for kids, online workshop, in which, in which we are sharing knowledge about very basic knowledge, since they are kids, like from 10 years to 15 years old. So we've got a group of 30 kids right now. And our second batch is also almost full now, which will be starting from the 4th of June. And trust me, the kids are enjoying it so much. I mean, and it's a different kind of satisfaction, you know, when you're sharing your knowledge about the wildlife and the birds and kids enjoying it. Because we know that in future, they'll go and take this up as a hobby.
Right. Very, very good initiative. Yeah. Very nice.
Again, we are not charging for it. It's just an initiative to spread awareness and spread knowledge and create love for nature and wildlife within kids.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We have a question. I'll take that. When we book a safari, what should be the criteria to select a particular zone or gate for assured sighting? Assured sighting, I won't say anything, but definitely answer that.
Assured. So this is when, before we plan any particular forest, like if we are planning Page. So before we went to Page, we knew that three different tigresses had cubs, like three cubs, some were with four cubs. So that's how we study, like almost 3 to 4 months of study and talking to the naturalists. And we know, you know, that when we had gone to Tadoba, there was one tigress, I think Maya, she was dominating the Panderponi Lake, and we had sighted her. When we sighted her, she was pregnant. So we calculated when she's going to deliver. Then 3 months, her cubs will be kept inside, and then they'll be out. So accordingly, we calculate the months, and then we plan our safari to Tadoba in those months when it will be easy to, chances will be high to spot those small cubs. So that's how we plan.
Okay, great. Anything else? Awad, I think you had unmuted. Do you have any question? Or anybody else has a question? If not, so first of all, to the participants who have joined the session today, thank you very much for joining and being a very good audience. I'm sure you liked what was presented. Please do join us for a few more sessions. We have one lined up tomorrow. And two interesting ones in the next weekend. So please look out for those. I haven't revealed what those are yet. So I will be advertising them tomorrow evening onwards. But definitely join the Birds of the Philippines tomorrow. So that's interesting. And coming back to Amisha and Rian, thank you very much for sharing your personal experiences with us. I had a jolly good ride. As Radhika said, she also had a virtual tour. So I'm sure everybody liked. You can see the chat. People are thanking you there. And for everyone, we will record. We have recorded this. I will be putting up on YouTube, and I will share the link with you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Francis, and everybody else as well.
Thanks. Thanks
so much, everybody.
Thank you.